plugged in. We'll take a ride on a mini train. We'll hear what some of the candidates had to say at the all candidates debate. We'll learn about speeding up your computer, and we'll join in on the Moose River Festival. Good evening and welcome to another edition of Plugged In, right here on Cogeco Community Television. I'm Tony Grace. Roger Bouffard has had a lifelong passion for trains, and now his dream of owning his own train has become a reality. Let's take a visit now to the Greenbeck Mini Train Farm.
Today we are on location at Greenbeck at the Mini Train Farm, and it is situated just outside of Rankin. And today my guest is Roger Bouffard, and I'm very glad to have you here today, Roger. And well, I just want to ask you, how did you get interested in making this train, and who helped you with it?
Well, first, when I was 16, I have to go back to that time, I was working in the mines. I started working in the mines, and after a couple months in the mine, I started to work on a small train, and I discovered I really liked it. A lot of time I made believe was my own little train, and it was quite enjoyable. And as time went on, I kind of dreamed of having a train myself later in my life.
Right.
It's kind of a too far-fetched dream. It would, you know, not likely ever happen. And then a few years back, I built the bridge here, covered bridge, and the train thought came back in my mind. I could see tracks, visualize tracks going through my bridge, and trains on the tracks just going. And
in your mind, yeah.
Then the feeling became stronger and stronger. Finally, last year, I couldn't resist. I thought, well, if I can build it, I'll go for it now. So last August, my wife and I decided that was it.
We'd build the train. Yeah.
So I took many trips to Northwest Quebec, Northwestern Ontario, and looking for the material. And came the end of November. Finally, after 5 months of search, I found some rails.
Oh.
No rails, no railroad.
No, that's right, yes.
So without rails, it's impossible. And from there, I kept looking, and I found some undercarriage of old car, mining cars, still in good shape. And I bought that, brought it home. And came January, I started to build a passenger car in my workshop. And it took me all winter. I built a car in about eight days.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, it took me all winter. By the end of March, I was all set for that. I started working on a locomotive and started to organize for the track. But we had so much rain in April, May, that I was delayed.
Yes.
And finally, I got going with the track in late May. My son Luke and Robert Reike helped me a lot on the track. And my son Luke helped me on every other aspect at the train as well.
How many miles of track do you have around here approximately?
I got 1.5, the right is a 1.5 kilometer long. And it takes 20 minutes. I would travel 3 miles an hour or 5 kilometers an hour.
And you carries 45 passengers?
45 to 54. It depends on how many adults, how many children we have.
And you have
six passenger cars.
Yeah.
I could add another two, which will bring 48 adults or 72 children.
Do you have very many seniors from clubs come out here and enjoy this ride around here?
We had a few. It's a little difficult to get going at this, but the one that came back.
Oh.
Within 3 weeks, they were back. They came as a club. And club member with no children, and within 2 weeks, 3 weeks, they pretty well all came back with their grandchildren.
Well, it certainly is a wonderful experience, and to think that when you first started, you had so many visualizations of what you were going to do, and this ended just like this. So everything is just beautiful. And when the people come out here, they can bring a lunch with them, and the buses that come out, or the people in cars.
Yeah, like we have a good parking. People could park the cars, buses to turn around. They don't even need to turn around. It's good parking and all that.
Yeah.
And a lot of them bring a lunch, light lunch. And normally they would stay about an hour. Some of them stay 2 or 3 hours and have lunch, go for a train ride, mm-hmm. have a lunch with the kids, and then go back again on a yeah. train ride. The kids want to go back with a shoe, so that's fine.
And I find that this bridge directly here is just wonderful, and I'm just going to go through there in a minute to continue on the journey mm-hmm. with this mini train, and I find it very, very interesting. And I would like to thank you, Roger, for being my guest today out here at the Greenbeck Farm.
It was my pleasure to have you.
Getting closer, the municipal elections are coming up on Monday, November the 10th, and we're very pleased to announce that Kojiko Community 12 has teamed up with Pembroke radio station Star 96 to bring you live election coverage on Monday, November the 10th. We'll have all the results for you as they come in. Again, that's live Monday, November the 10th, right here on Kojiko Community 12. And as we head to the polls for our municipal elections, city candidates had a chance to present their platforms to the public at an all-candidates meeting held on Monday, October the 27th. And just a reminder that we will be rebroadcasting that on Wednesday, November the 5th at 10 p.m. So tune in and hear what all the candidates had to say. Here's a sample right now of what some of them had to say.
Of how the rules and regulations will go for this evening.
I agree that there is definitely room for improvement with what we're doing right now.
And Dr. Lee suggested that the savings from the garbage should go to the taxpayers.
My whole philosophy in regards to interest in business is that it does not mix with government.
Well, if some business wants to come in, you make sure and be definite in providing whatever assistance you can.
And they said, we're not interested unless the population is 30,000 people.
My whole philosophy also is focusing your economic strategy in the high-tech industry.
And I feel that we're not pursuing industry aggressively enough.
The provincial government has identified that one of the leading industries in our province is tourism.
That the tax rate or the taxes that you pay at this time will not be going down. they'll be reshifted to another area.
Ladies and gentlemen, the real world is that what we're told by government sometimes isn't so.
I believe the waterfront development should be being put down where the old splint was to be.
The waterfront, without a doubt, is our greatest asset. Whenever we talk about waterfront, it's something that really strikes me as being the key to any kind of development Pembroke's going to have.
And take some private money as well as tax money. And yes, the river is opening up.
Then you have to make sure that you make it viable for the people who are going to come in and spend the dollars. They can't come in and say, this is where we want to build, and we say, sorry, if you want to build, it's back over there and behind the trees.
The days of us trying to attract General Motors or Ford into this community, they never were very good, and they are absolutely zero right now.
Studies will show you, economic studies will show you in this country, that the majority of the expansion that occurs, the economic expansion that occurs in the community, is with existing businesses, and that's what we have to do.
The downloading of services are going to impact on our municipality like we have never seen before.
I'm all for high-tech jobs in Pembroke, but where are we going to get them? That's a problem.
The Police Services Board saw fit to hire a community police officer with a presence downtown to address some of those problems regarding the need of a police person.
Facts you probably didn't know. In 1876, the first steam train reached Pembroke. It later became a part of the Canadian Pacific Railway. There were three industries established in the city in 1920 and 1921. The Canadian Splint and Lumber Company, Eddie Match, and Superior Electric all started operations during those 2 years. And 1957 marked the year that the Allumette Island Bridge opened to the public, linking Ontario to the island. We'll be right back.
Johnson and Joanne McLeod.
My name's Tanya, and I'll be your server today. Eating at a restaurant doesn't mean you have to throw away plans for healthy eating. It really just depends on what you choose.
Healthy eating is the average of what you've eaten over time, and the choices may be balanced throughout the day or several days. When you choose food on the go, there are ways to balance the high-fat choices with lower-fat ones.
And don't be shy. Ask for what you want. Fish, meat, and chicken that is broiled or baked instead of fried. Low-fat milk in your coffee instead of cream.
Sauces on the side and low-fat salad dressings can control the amount that goes on your food. And you can still satisfy your taste buds. Food on the go, like sandwiches, can be made easily with a few low-fat choices, such as mustard instead of mayonnaise, and serve topped with lots of veggies. And vary your choices of potatoes. Have a baked potato with salsa or sour cream on the side, and occasionally order those French fries.
It's amazing to see how minor changes to a meal can make a big difference.
So until next time, eat well, be active, and feel good about yourself. That's vitality. Hey.
Break.
Let's take a look now at milestones, some events from the past. 5 years ago at the Algonquin Cinemas, people were lining up to see The Babe and White Men Can't Jump. Carried over from the previous week was Beethoven and Sleepwalkers. The Renfrew County Separate School Board passed some recommendations at council. Among these suggestions were computers in the classrooms be high on the priority list, and that the Hyla Bishop Smith Research Center be included in the 1992 budget. 10 years ago, the Bank of Canada rate was at 8.26%, while the Canadian dollar was at 75.7 cents US. From April 21st to 28th, 1987, the Pembroke Little Theatre production of Educating Rita was playing at Festival Hall. The tearing down of the old Cockburn and Archer building on Pembroke Street was well underway. In the same week, the United States Ambassador Thomas Niles made a visit to Pembroke. Also, a bylaw was passed through council, which was to start May 1st, 1987, that would legalize parking on the west side of Pembroke Street. And 15 years ago, cottage rolls were priced at $1.58 per pound, while back bacon sold for $1.98 a pound. 365 men and 5 women applied at the Pembroke Union office for work on the Trans-Canada Pipeline Project. Pipeline officials hired 400 to 500 people from this area for work on the pipeline. And at the theaters, Bill Murray starred in Stripes, while Paul Newman and Sally Field took the lead roles in Absence of Malice. There's a simple and cost-effective way to improve your computer's performance. Sean Banky has the details on this week's Cogeco Compute.
This week's Cogeco Compute Tip has to deal about increasing your system's performance. Now, the most economical way to do this is adding RAM to your computer system. Now, depending on the computer system you have, will depend on what kind of RAM you get. The most common is what's called 72-pin SIM. The newest one that's out on some of the Pentium motherboards is what's called a 168-pin DIMM. Now, depending on the motherboard you have will depend on how much RAM you put on your system. For instance, if you have a 486 computer, you don't necessarily have to put the 72-pin SIMs in pairs. However, you do have to put them on the Pentium motherboards. Now, I'm going to show you how to install the RAM on your motherboard. The board that we'll be installing the RAM on happens to be a Pentium motherboard. Now, as I mentioned before, on the Pentium motherboards, you have to put your SIMs in pairs. Now, I already have one SIM installed here. When you're installing RAM into your computer system, you have to remember one thing before you put it in. Well, one, make sure that you're properly grounded. Two, there'll be a little notch located on the edge of the SIM. Now, this notch will only be on one side. What this is for is to prevent you from putting the SIM in improperly, the wrong way. It will only go in one way. Now, when I go to install this, I'm going to simply turn it around, carefully just slide it in so it's sitting there on its own weight. Now, it will be in on a high angle, and it's just sitting there right now. Now, there's two metal tabs on either side. Now, what this is going to do is it's going to simply snap the SIM into place. You also got two little plastic notches which will line up with the two holes that are either side of the SIM. Now, all you got to do when you put this in is simply click it up and you'll hear it snap. The metal tabs will snap in on either side. That way you know the SIM itself is securely in place and you're good to go. That's how easy it is to get the SIM installed. As you can see, it's not that difficult a procedure to install RAM in your system. It is the most cost-efficient way in order to increase your overall system's performance. The main thing is you can never have enough memory. The more memory you add to your system, the more you're going to be able to do run more programs at once. For Cogeco CompuTip, I'm Sean Banky.
Whitewater kayaking is a sport that has grown in popularity over the past few years. But Jason Rusin, a volunteer here at Cogeco Community 12, and some of his friends decided that what the Ottawa River had to offer wasn't quite enough for them. So they packed up and headed to New York State. And they decided to share their trip with us.
The Ottawa River is our playground, second home to us. And in September, our playground is home to the world. The World Whitewater Rodeo Championships are held on the Ottawa River. And it was here that we found out about the Moose River Festival in Old Forge, New York. So we packed our gear and headed south. Time on the road was well spent, convincing the border guards to allow us into the country, not getting lost, and the occasional stop at Burger King. However, we were not alone. Over 500 other boaters were our company. A new river awaited us. Kayakers were not alone. Rafts, sport yaks, and cataracts were also present on the river. Big drops, a lack of volume of water, sheer number of people provided opportunity for numerous mistakes and injury. We left with a few more scratches on our boats, a few new friends, and all smiles.
Let's take a look now at some events of interest coming up in the area. The Lions Club of Petawawa presents its annual Santa Claus Parade. That's coming up on November the 23rd. The theme this year is All I Want for Christmas. Call 687-5020 for more information. The Red Cross is offering a babysitting course on November the 22nd and 23rd from 9 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. both days. It will be held at the Red Cross office located at 1217 Pembroke Street East. And for more information, you can call 735-1157. Tables are still available for the Holy Name 3rd Annual Craft and Bake Sale. It's coming up November the 15th from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. and will be held at the church located on 1st Avenue in the West End. Call 735-6116. There will be a much music video dance party at the Catering Hall on Julian Street on Friday, November the 7th. Preteens can dance from 6 till 8 p.m. The teen dance goes from 8:30 to midnight. Cost for preteens is $2.50 and $6 for teens. Call 687-2711. And finally, the Civic Hospital will be holding an allergy clinic coming up on Thursday, November the 13th, Friday, November the 14th, and Tuesday, November the 18th. A referral is necessary. For more information, please feel free to call the Pembroke Civic Hospital anytime. That's going to wrap it up for another edition of Plugged In right here on Kojiko Community 12. Thanks a lot for watching. And we'll just remind you again that Wednesday, November the 5th at 10 p.m., you can tune in for the full broadcast of the Pembroke All Candidates debate, which was held on Monday, October the 27th. And don't forget, Monday, November the 10th, we'll be presenting live election coverage. So for everybody here on Plugged In, I'm Tony Grace. Thanks a lot for watching. Have a good night.